Okay. The next learning objective is I, which is being able to define biological classification as organization of species according to shared characteristics. And then phylogeny, you must be able to define as organization of species to show the evolutionary relationship, okay, between the organisms you're looking at. J is looking at modes of speciation, so allopatric, sympatric, and for your syllabus, when you're looking at allopatric usually arises due to a geographical barrier, and for sympatric, it can either be because of behavioral isolation or physiological isolation. Okay, so you must be able to describe what is the barrier in that event that leads to allopatric or sympatric, respectively. Okay, then the last thing, advantages of molecular methods. So usually when we look at the advantages, we are kind of looking at molecular methods. Why is it better than, say, looking at anatomical features or morphological features? So it's a comparison. So either you are describing why a molecular method is better, or you're describing why looking at morphological features is not so good in certain cases. Alright, that's the idea. Okay, so let's look at natural selection. So I'm going to summarize natural selection by listing out the usual questions that come up. Okay, so these are the usual questions at the right that will come up for natural selection. If you notice, the one with the three arrows, right, are the questions that came out in your promos essay. Okay, if you recall, the ones with the green arrow are the ones that came up for your promos essay. Okay, which I will touch on again in detail at the end of this lecture, because I'm going to go through your promo essay to give you examiner's comments. Okay, let's look at natural selection in a nutshell. This is the picture Mr. Chua used, the one on the left. So the idea is there is phenotypic variation naturally existing in the population. So if you look at the beetles here, the phenotypic variation is that you have green beetles, you have brown beetles. Alright, what is the selection pressure in this case? The predator. Alright, the predator, the bird. Alright, so the bird is going to select for whichever beetle it can see better. So the ground is brown, so it can see the green beetles better. Alright, because it's not camouflage. Alright, so it's going to eat the green beetles, whereas the brown beetles have a selective advantage, so they will... they have a higher chance to survive to maturity, reproduce, so higher reproductive success, and then they will pass down their alleles genes to the next generation, and then over time, you have change in allele frequency in that population. Okay, and that definition of change in allele frequency is the definition for microevolution. Alright. Okay, let's look at the one that I've underlined first. I'm going to go through each of these questions to give you kind of like a pictorial summary of what you should be, what is expected in the answer. Alright, so the first one, sources of variation and why it's important for them. So something like this. This was your promos question. Okay, this is packed to learning objective A in your syllabus. So as you can see, the first part are the different processes that will give rise to variation. Only gene mutation will give rise to new alleles. The rest of them are just giving you new combinations of existing alleles. Alright, the rest of the processes. All of them will give rise to genotypic or genetic variation. And this is important because when you have genotypic variation, that leads to phenotypic variation. And phenotypic variation is what natural selection acts on. Alright, and when you describe this answer, you must briefly mention how natural selection happens. So you need to describe the process of natural selection, which I just did for you previously. And you also, it depends on the number of marks that you see in the question. If you feel you have written until that and the number of, is it sufficient to answer the number of marks, you can leave it at that. If you want to be cautious, you can add in the last part, which is to mention if there is no phenotypic variation, then natural selection has no effect. Okay? That will be a very good answer. Okay, let me give you some time to process. Alright, okay. Okay, let's look at the next two questions. I'm going to put it together because they are rather similar. Okay, how natural selection may bring about evolution. So for the first one, you just describe. So Darwin's theory of natural selection, you just describe until natural selection, then you stop. If they ask you the second one, explain how natural selection may bring about evolution, you need to describe natural selection, and then you need to link it to evolution. Alright? Okay, so this is learning objective C. What do you need to do? It might be a general essay question, so you may not have any context, but if it is a structured question and there's a context, then please tailor your answer to the context. Okay? So if not, a standard answer will go something like this, which is what I described previously. Alright, so phenotypic variation already exists. There's a selection pressure. You must state what the pressure is. Then phenotypes that are suited to the environment will be selected for, or the keyword here is selective advantage. And higher reproductive success. Higher reproductive success means I must see both the words. They are more likely, so the concept of having a higher chance to survive and reproduce. The word survive and reproduce must be there. Alright? And then the next important thing you have to state is pass down favorable alleles or genes to their offspring or the next generation. And over time, how do I get this to disappear? Okay, never mind. Okay, so over time, allele frequency for the favorable phenotype increases in the gene pool. Alright, and that's the definition for microevolution. Alright, so another thing I want to state here is the question is about. If I'm not wrong, in your promos was about natural selection leading to. Okay, it's not this question, sorry. I will come to that concept later. Okay, is this clear? Clear? Okay. So we'll move to one. Alright, this is back to learning objective B, which is using examples. Alright, to describe the process of natural selection. So, four examples were given to you. I'm not going to go through all of them, but it's important for you to know most of them, at least three. Okay, so what are the examples? First one is on the peppered moth, okay, the one on the left. Then the one on the right here is on Darwin's finches. Alright, then the one at the bottom is on how sickle cell carriers in malaria-infested regions have a resistance to malaria. Alright, so they have a selective advantage. Okay, so that was the example. And the last one on bottom there, the very cute picture, is on antibiotic resistance. Okay, about how you're using or abusing antibiotics, and that's leading to this phenomenon where you have very drug-resistant bacteria developing. Okay, and this is a very real problem. My cropping is horrible, so I wasn't able to crop the title. But anyway, the idea is antibiotic abuse is leading to a lot of people dying in Thailand. This is a very recent problem. I don't know whether you read it in the papers. This came out on November 12th this year. Alright, and the problem is that in Thailand, you can actually buy antibiotics without prescription. Alright, so you see the title there. Okay, so they can just walk into the pharmacy and like how you buy rice or vegetables, they can just buy antibiotics. Okay, so that's a real issue, and hopefully over time the government will regulate this. Okay, so if you're interested, you can go and read up on this article. Okay. Okay, along the way I will show you some of this to kind of bring about the relevance of evolution. Okay, it's still relevant. What you're studying is still relevant to what's happening now. Alright, so to kind of bring across that idea to you. Okay, let's move on. Okay, the last two questions. you should be able to explain how genetic variation may be preserved in a natural population. This came out in your promos. A common misconception for this question was, it's not asking how genetic variation arises. So you shouldn't be describing sources of variation. We are talking about variation that's already there. How does it remain in the population? Okay, that's the focus of your answer. Okay, and the next one was why population is the smallest unit that can evolve. Alright, so let's look at the kind of point form for each of these. So I've written down the learning objectives related to them. Okay, for the top one, I will not go into greater detail, but there's an entire section of the notes dedicated to this that Mr. Chua went through. So I'm just going to jog your memory that the concepts are heterozygote protection, the idea that in diploid organisms, in the heterozygote condition, you have one dominant allele, one recessive allele, and the effect of the recessive allele is masked by the dominant allele. Alright, so though the phenotype you see is is the dominant phenotype, the recessive allele will still be passed down to the offspring. So in that sense, the phenotype that is that will manifest due to the recessive allele remains in the population. Alright, so that genetic variation is preserved. Okay? Then heterozygote advantage is earlier what we looked at, sickle cell carriers in malaria-infested areas. Alright, they have a selective advantage. Alright? And then frequency-dependent selection, where the fitness of the phenotype depends on its frequency in the population. Okay? So if you're more frequent, then you're going to be more easily spotted by the predator, and you're going to be more likely preyed upon. Okay? So what happens is, the one that's of a that's less frequent, right, will remain in the population. Okay, that means the genetic variation of those group of individuals is preserved. Okay? The next question, explain why population is the smallest unit that can evolve. Okay, I will come to this again as well. It's very good that many of you know why individuals cannot evolve. You know this, right? Individuals cannot evolve, okay, but we will touch on it again. In any case, to answer this question, you need to understand what evolution is. Okay, so the definition for evolution. Then you need to define a population. And then the earlier answer, where we looked at the standard answer for natural selection, you need to bring that in. And then you need to end off by linking to evolution. And that is why a population is the smallest unit that can evolve. Okay, because natural selection acts on individuals. And it's within a population of individuals that you can actually see the change in allele frequency. Okay, to clarify, the evolution that we are talking about here, is it micro or macro evolution? You're linking the evolution, right, to answer the question. Is it micro or macro? Also quiet, never eat breakfast. I don't know anybody also. Guess? Okay, it's a population. So if you're looking at a population, is it micro or macro? Micro. Okay, so it's micro. So some of you, when you wrote your promo answer, right, you were linking to macro evolution, which is beyond the species level already. Right, a population is one species. Alright, so the evolution we are talking about here must be micro. Alright? Okay, shall we move on? Alright. Okay, the last thing within natural selection you need to know about, even in the old syllabus, it did not get tested very often, but it's good for you to know. Okay, the three modes of natural selection. So you have stabilizing selection. So this idea that If it's more or less, okay, it is selected against. So whatever is within the middle range is selected for. So in your notes, the example was the birth weight of a child. So if the child is too heavy or the child is too light, it doesn't survive very well. Okay, because if it's too heavy, it's probably very difficult for the mother to give birth, or it's obese, and whatever other diseases will come about. Or if it's very small, then probably it did not develop very well, or it's malnourished, or something of that sort. So similarly here, for birds, right, when they lay eggs, they realize that larger clutches means that you cannot nourish all the chicks very well, so it doesn't survive that well as well. But if it's a smaller clutches, you might not have enough individuals who might be strong enough to survive. Because you know, animals, right, sometimes they actually have more offspring, so that, because some of them will die off. So it's like, who survives? Survival of the fittest. Okay? So you have more, so hopefully some survive. So that concept. Okay? So for directional selection, is your peppered moth. So the idea that when there was industrialization and the trees became soot covered, the melanic form or the darker form was selected for. So there was a directional shift that over generations you see more dark colored moth compared to the peppered one, the white one. Okay, so you see the shift. Okay, the shift is the blue becoming the red. Okay, after natural selection, similarly here, the blue becoming the red. So that's your directional selection towards the right in this case. Okay, the last one is diversifying selection. So in this population, you have the grey and the Himalayan, grey white. So basically, three different types now. Okay, one that's very dark, one that's white, and one that's greyish. So the idea is in a rocky environment, the grey and the slightly grey one survive better than the white coloured one. Alright, so there's a directional selection where the one in the middle is selected against and the one at the extremes are selected for. Okay, so this is the example where if any particular barrier if there's a barrier that separates these two populations and they accumulate differences differently for sufficiently long enough, then they might become two different species. Okay, it might lead to speciation. Okay. Okay, now we're going to move on to the concepts within the second series of lectures. So you need to know species concept. There are too many species concepts. You have this big, huge table. Unfortunately, you need to know the concepts within that table. But I'm not going to spend the time to go through it again. I think Mr. Koh did a good job. So these are the five concepts you need to know. You need to know the definition, you need to know the advantages of each of the concepts, and you need to know their limitations as well. Okay? Okay, let me give you a standard answer for speciation question. Usually when you approach a speciation question, this is what you need to talk about. You need to bring about the idea that in this scenario, there's been reproductive isolation. Okay, or between the two subpopulations, there is no gene flow. Okay, and you make reference to either the idea that there's allopatric speciation, so that means there's been some geographical barrier. They are completely separated from each other. Or sympatric, they're still within the same area, but because of some difference in their behavior or some difference in their physiology, they have been isolated. Okay? So, whatever the difference, you make reference to that. So, when I say different environment here, I'm making reference to the geographical isolation. So, if it's behavioral or physiological, you make reference to that. Okay, you tailor your answer. So, different environment means different selection pressure. So, different phenotypes are selected for in the two subpopulations. So, you have different reproductive success. So different individuals surviving, reproducing, and passing down their alleles to the offspring. So over time, in the two subpopulation, the differences will accumulate such that over time, they are no longer able to interbreed to form viable, fertile offspring. So at that point, we say speciation has occurred. All right? Okay, so that will be your answer. Okay, so let's look at the next one, which is the different type of reproductive barriers that there are. Okay, you have this picture in your notes as well. Okay, we tried to do a summary to make it clearer for you. Okay, if you look at your syllabus, they only make reference to geographical isolation. So you need to know geographical isolation leading to allopatric speciation, and you need to know behavioral and physiological isolation leading to sympatric. Okay, but it's good for you to know the rest as well, just in case there is some question, okay, that comes up, or in future, they decide to give you something interesting, novel context. Okay. What is geographical? So basically barrier, I think you know that. Ecological, so when we say ecological, right, what does that mean? It means like, okay, lions and tigers, right, they stay within the same territory, but basically they have different habitats. Okay, so this is a definition you can use. So when you say ecological isolation, they are within the same territory, but they have different habitats. So the grassland and the forested area are different habitats. Okay, then behavioral isolation, basically a different behavior. So only individuals who display the same behavior, they want to mate with them. I have a cute video I will show you later. Okay. Physiological isolation, so basically plants that flower at different times, or the mating organs of the individuals are not compatible. Alright. Or the gametes are not compatible. So basically, the sperm cannot recognize the receptors on the egg, so maybe it's not able to fuse with it. So even if they mate, you will not be able to form, there will be no fertilization to form a zygote. Okay, then here the example given is hybrid infertility. So sadly, when the horse and the donkey mate and you have the mule, okay, the mule is infertile, okay, and will not be able to have its own offspring. Alright, why is that so? If you look at the chromosome number given to you, okay, 64, 62, so the male has 63 chromosomes. So if you recall, meiosis is the process where your chromosome number is halved, and then during fertilization, your chromosome number is restored. Okay, but for the male, right, if you were to undergo meiosis, the process, it will fail to produce normal gametes, because it's odd number of chromosomes. Okay, and because of that, basically, you won't be able to produce viable fertile offspring. Alright, so this is only one example given. If you look at your notes, there are two others given. You have the hybrid is not viable, and you have another example which is hybrid breakdown. Okay, so these are the more common examples. The other two, for your information, you can read as well. It may come out, it might not come out. Alright. Okay. Okay, let's look at speciation. Allopatric, sympatric. Okay, so different diagrammatic examples to show you what they are. So in this case, you have a valley that has separated the valley here that has separated the trees. So this was the ancestral species, the dark green one, and the one on the right, right? Depending on the environment, you might have a different variant that was selected for. So over time, they accumulate differences and they might no longer be able to interbreed. So is now a new species. Okay? Then the one on the right here is looking at within the same area, you actually have this group. So a different variant that has arisen. And for this example of the trees, right, it's probably going to be physiological isolation. So because maybe this group of plants, right, may be flowering at a different time. So they may not be able to cross-fertilize and they might develop accumulate differences over time, and then they may no longer be able to interbreed. Alright, so there will be speciation. Okay, so for ecological isolation, mentioned earlier, like maybe the tiger and the lions, that's one example. Behavioral isolation could be birds' mating call. So what happens is certain species, right, they have very unique mating calls. So only individuals who are able to do that, right, they'll mate with them. So even maybe like, for example, birds are very closely related species, right, if they cannot perform that mating ritual, right, they will not mate with them. Right, so to take a break, okay, let me show you something. You need a break, right? Okay. See, my technology is so bad. Okay, thank you. I'm trying to make this bigger. Okay. Hopefully, please. Okay. Must increase here, so I can hear.
On the Galapagos Islands, blue-footed boobies are just starting their families. Blue-footed boobies also dance to form partnerships. Each movement mirrors the other. Like flamingos, they seem to fall for birds like themselves. Compatible. Booby means clown. Their big blue feet are an important part of the costume. Blue feet are important because the blue colour is hard to mate, especially if the birds are in poor condition. It's an honest indicator of good health. So they show them. Unlike flamingos, boobies continue their courtship displays even after nesting starts, as though they weren't quite sure of each other.
That's the app. I'm not sure what it does.
I think that's the update.
Is it okay?
And then, while their partners are away feeding, both sexes flirt with their neighbors.
It cannot stop. It cannot stop.
The truth is that boobies have a roving eye.
Okay, you're not supposed to hear the last part, Okay, which is about them having extramarital affairs. Okay, but the idea was basically, this was an example given in your notes. They're called the blue-footed boobies, this bird. So they're very beautiful, bright blue-colored legs, feet, which they use in a mating ritual where the males are supposed to dance, and that dance where they flap up their wings and they basically dance, okay, is called the high step. Okay, so the male has to do that as part of the mating ritual, alright, for them to mate. Okay, so that's a very unique mating call, a mating ritual, which has to be performed, and because of that, they need that to be done before they mate. So closely related species that may not be able to do that, they will not mate with them. Alright, so it's a very effective behavioral barrier, reproductive barrier. Okay? Okay, we need to move on. If we have time, then we will watch more fun videos later. Okay, so to summarize, whenever there's a question, you need to describe the process of natural selection and whatever reproductive isolative mechanism has happened, and then talk about the speciation event that has happened. Okay, so this is a summary of the whole process. So this is how natural selection, reproductive barrier lead to speciation, how the concepts are linked. Okay. Okay, let's look at the next part, which is evidence of evolution. So you have anatomical homology, molecular homology, and whatever info you get from that will be used to construct the phylogenetic tree. So it advises on the evolutionary relationship between species, and then you can put them, you can construct your phylogenetic tree. And some of them I'll go into detail, some I won't. So for molecular homology, generally it's the fact that there's a universal genetic code, all right, where all organisms, they have the ATCG. Right, and you can look at DNA and amino acid sequence similarities to kind of tell you how closely related or distantly related species are. Okay, then the other two evidences that we look at would be biogeography, so where organisms are located in the globe. All right, and your fossil record. So basically, what both of these tell you is they give you some sort of evolutionary history. Alright, of species. Alright, and that information should be aligned with the way you have constructed your phylogenetic tree. Okay? Okay, so this comparison between divergent convergent evolution, so linked to anatomical homology. So you already have this table. I just want to clarify something and give you another example. Okay, under homologous structure, right, when we were talking about may appear morphologically different, if you look at the structures on your right, so these structures, I don't know if you can see the outline, but if you notice the outline of the thing, so for example, the outline of the hand and the outline of the flipper, so morphologically they look different. Alright, but internally, if you look at the structure, it's actually the same basic structure, which within each of the organisms, there might be a bit of a variation. So what do we mean by basic structure? The basic structure is pentadactyl limb. Penta means five, so you have five dactyls, okay, so five digits. Alright, so if you look at the color variation, there's one here, orange one, yellow one, and another lightish orange one and a brown one at the bottom. So five different digits. Okay, so if you notice, that's the basic structure, but the way the five digits appear in each of the organisms are slightly different. So here is slightly shorter, the brown color region, whereas here in the whale, it's basically slightly elongated. Right, so that's what we mean when we talk about homologous structure. There is the same basic structure, but when you look at how there are variations, right? So it suggests that these organisms, they have gotten this structure from an ancestral organism that had a basic structure. Okay, so that's the idea of descent with modification. So whatever I described in red basically provides evidence for descent with modification. Okay? Okay, to digress a bit, you had an example of streamlined appendages in fish, dolphin, penguins for the analogous structure. Another interesting one is the pangolin and armadillo. Okay, have you heard of the pangolin? Have, right? Pangolin, very cute, right? Okay, I don't know if you all find it cute, but I find it cute. So if you have gone to the zoo, I think most definitely you have seen it. Okay. Okay, so you should have seen this. So this donation, cute structure for you to donate. If I'm not wrong, Jurong Point also has one, but it's a super old mall, so I don't know whether y'all have gone there. Okay. Okay. There are only 8 species of pangolins left in the world. Alright. And most of them, if not all, are either vulnerable, endangered, critically endangered because of illegal poaching. Okay, so that's very sad. They're very cute because when the predator tries to, you know, disturb them, they will curl into a ball and try to save themselves. And an interesting feature they have is this external shields or plates. They're actually made of keratin, so like our nails. Nails, hair, okay, is the same material, slightly more hardy. So that's a defensive mechanism that they have. And the interesting thing is, this same defensive mechanism, the armadillo also have. So as we would think that they are closely related, which is always the misconception for analogous structures. So basically, the structures they have, and the purpose they use it for is similar. In this case, but when they went to do molecular analysis, right, they realized that the pangolin and the armadillos have no close taxonomic relationship. Okay, so this is another example of analogous structures. Okay, so just for your info. Okay. Okay. Let's look at the other two evidences, biogeography. So for biogeography, is simply this idea that species. If you notice, they are not evenly distributed around the globe, and if those that basically are closely related will be found closer to each other. So the idea is just that you will find species where there or somewhere near to where their common ancestors were. All right. So it's a descent from a common ancestor. That's the idea. Okay, so the examples that Mr. Chua, I think, did this lecture has given you would be polar bears, elephants. I think he discussed those quite detail. So maybe the marsupials, right? I will give you the evolutionary history of the marsupials. Okay, just for your info. This one I must. Okay. So for marsupials, I think he mentioned that. The placentals are more efficient than the marsupials, all right? Which is why in most parts of the world, where there was competition from placentals, the marsupials basically died out, okay? And the placentals won. Okay, so what was the history? So the history was that when parts of the world were still joined together, so North America, I think Asia and Europe joined together, they were called Laurasia, you had marsupials. What happened was the marsupials moved from China to North America, and at that time North America, South America was joined together. Okay, so they moved down to South America as well. After which North and South America separated. Okay, then the placentals in North America and the rest of the world kind of worn out, so the marsupials died. But in South America, right, they kind of survived because there was no much competition. Okay, there was competition, but I think the environment suited them better, so they kind of won the placentals. Then, at that point, South America was also linked to Antarctica and to Australia. Okay, so they kind of moved through some sort of marsupial, moved from South America to Antarctica to Australia. Okay, which is why, in brackets, you will find marsupial fossils in Antarctica. Okay, but then what happened is they basically broke off. Australia broke off, and there was no competition from marsupials there, from placentals, so marsupials kind of flourished. But in South America, you still have some marsupials, but in Antarctica, when it broke off and the climate cooled, right, the marsupials died out. So you only find fossils there, you will not find the mammals there. Right, so that's the history. If you're wondering why you see fossils in Antarctica, all right, but you and the organisms, right, marsupials, you see some in Australia, some in South America. All right? Okay, then the other concept that was brought in is island colonization, Galapagos and Cape Verde. Okay, the idea is when you have islands that have the same climate, same soil, same everything, one would expect the organisms to look similar found on these islands, but that's not the case. What scientists have observed is that two different islands that are far apart, though they may have everything that's the same, the organisms, that means the flora, the plant species, and the fauna, the animal species, are not the same. Instead, each of the islands, right, whatever they have resembles the continents nearby. Right, which suggests that this species may have arisen from a common ancestor that was from that particular continent. Okay? So that's the evidence for evolution. That means descent from a common ancestor. Okay? Okay, then we have fossil record. So for fossil record, these are the things you need to know. You need to be aware of being able to reconstruct life in chronological order. Okay, so stratigraphy and radiometric dating. So stratigraphy, right, is relative age because you're not actually dating the fossil itself, you're dating the rock the fossil is found in. And because you're dating the rock and the fossil is found in that rock, you are kind of estimating the age of the fossil. So it's relative. Whereas when you do radiometric dating, you are actually using elements within the fossil and taking note of their half-life. Okay, so that's absolute age of the fossil. Okay, and then transitional fossils are very important because they kind of reaffirm your conclusion that, for example, birds evolved from reptiles. So Archaeopteryx is giving you that link or reaffirming that link. And Tiktaalik is reaffirming the link that amphibians evolved from fish. Okay? Okay. Right, okay, I'm going to speed up a bit. Classification, you just did this recently, Miss Tay just did it with y'all, so I'm not going to go into much. This is more FYI for you, the different categories that you need to, the different categories that exist in this linear classification. The one at the bottom is just a mnemonic that we use to give students for them to remember kingdom to species, but you don't need it lah. Because it's not really in your syllabus. Okay, what's more important? Okay, this is also FYI for you. The kingdoms, right? Kingdoms can be classified into bigger categories, which are your domains. Okay, so there are basically three big domains. So the domains will be bacteria, archaea, and eukarya. Okay, and then within eukarya, you have your kingdom, plantae, fungi, animalia, etc. Okay? Okay, phylogeny, you would have gone through as well in greater detail. So just to reiterate that you need to be able to read the trees. Okay? So, ancestor, descendants, and the node is where you have the speciation event, and you must be able to tell where the common ancestors of different descendants are. Okay, just gonna move on to this. Okay, I don't know if it's too small for you. Okay, in previous syllabus, right, you needed to make an explicit comparison between classification phylogeny. In this syllabus, they don't explicitly say that, but a question might come out. So, since you've already studied, you should be able to make your own comparisons. I'm just listing a few. If you can make them better, if you can refine them, or you can add on your own, please do so. Okay, so... Okay, if I zoom... Sorry... Okay, let's briefly go through. So, what is the basis of the grouping? So, in classification, you're just looking at observable characteristics that are similar. Whereas in phylogeny, you are trying to look at traits that are shared basically between the ancestor, the most recent ancestor, and the descendants. Okay, and try to group it that way. So, in that sense, it kind of shows the evolutionary relationship. So that brings us to the next point. Classification, you don't care about evolutionary relationships or you don't take it into consideration. Phylogeny, you do. And in classification, there is actually a system. So earlier we looked at it, so kingdom, phyla... Okay, I cannot remember. Okay, so basically that system. Okay? Okay, it's here, it's here. Okay? The genera into family, family into order, blah, blah, blah. Okay? Whereas phylogeny, you're not looking at that taxonomic system. So the taxonomic system is a human construct. Okay? It was brought about by this scientist, that Linnaeus guy. Alright? Okay? Then in classification, to make it easier and to kind of make sure you don't confuse with common names, you have a scientific name. So there's a binomial naming system. Alright, so your genus name and then the specific epithet. Whereas for phylogeny, we don't really have that. Okay, or we make use of the name that comes from the Linnaean system. Okay, then the next point is related to evolutionary relationship. Okay, when you take into consideration evolutionary relationship, in the end, when you look at the phylogenetic tree, you should be able to tell the evolutionary history of a particular species. Okay, so these two points are quite related. So try not to write them together if possible. Okay, unless it's a lot of marks and you just need to write as many as possible. Okay. Okay, the last one. Do you need molecular analysis? Okay, so for classification, you don't. You're looking at observable features, morphological features. Whereas in phylogeny, you will need. You will tend to look at molecular analysis, okay, to advise you on the evolutionary relationship, how closely related they are, okay, or distantly related. Okay. Okay, that's a comparison. Alright. Okay, advantages, I don't need to go through lah. Okay, you just did it yesterday, right? Okay, very good. Okay. I've just highlighted, so when you look at, you go back to look at the notes, right? Why have I highlighted the last two in red? Because the front few, right, is more of advantages of using molecular methods. The last two is more of disadvantages of using other methods. So in a sense, it indirectly answers the question lah. Okay, just to differentiate that. Okay. Okay, we have some time, so maybe we will do this. Okay, and then we can do the promo discussion tomorrow. Okay, let's look at this. Okay, can you briefly or quickly or actively tell me what you think might be wrong with whatever is mentioned here? Sorry? I only hear how? Can I anyhow pick people? Mister, you help me. Ricardo, okay, who's Ricardo? Yes. Please help me, what's wrong with this? How can you improve it? Okay, yes, thank you very much. So maybe just during winter. So if you realize London has four seasons, okay, I couldn't think of any other country. So what he mentioned, maybe only during winter. Okay, during the other seasons, it might not be beneficial to have thick fur. Okay, something like this, beneficial trait might be handicapped in another context, so may not always be a selective advantage. Okay. Do you have another lecture after this? No. Okay. Then let's quickly do this. Okay. Birds evolve wings to fly. What's wrong with this? I should bring in this. Ignatius. I know Ignatius, yes. They don't evolve wings. Why is that? Why does that have a wrong connotation? sounds plausible. Just try, it's okay. Change in allele frequency in the population over time. Okay, how does the process of natural selection happen? Okay, somewhat. That's the idea. So it's just that they might have been variants where some may not be able to fly, some might be able to fly, something of that sort, and it was selected for. So this statement makes it sound deliberate, alright, which is okay, so it's not deliberate, it's just that the diversity exists and the environment will select. So if you ever need to mention such a statement, it might be better to say wings evolve rather than say that the birds evolve, because it makes it sound like the birds did something deliberately. Alright? Okay, the rest of it, I'm going to go through quickly. Okay, because it's going to take a lot of time if you all try. Okay, evolution is a process that improves. Organisms steadily improve until they are perfectly adapted. Okay, you should feel like something's wrong. Okay, again, almost the same idea. It's this idea that they are keeping up with the environment. Okay, so depending on what's in the environment, individuals that are better suited will just survive and reproduce. Okay, it's not like they are consciously trying to become better and better. Okay, it's not a deliberate process. Okay, every organism leaves fossils, so any absence of evidence disproves evolution. So that means if you don't see fossils, you say evolution did not happen. That means that's the idea. You know this is not right. Because Mr. Chua mentioned many, many times that it's very rare that fossils happen. It's a very specific process, so you might not actually see fossils, okay? But that does not mean that evolution did not happen. But if you do find fossils, like the transitional fossils, that's when we are very happy, okay? Because, yeah, it's a big step. Okay, another one, individuals can evolve. Cute, right? Okay, not true, you know this. Okay, individuals do not evolve because their genome is fixed, which is why you need a group of individuals where natural selection can act on, and within that population you see a change, and that's where evolution has happened. Okay, in response to environmental change, organisms acquire mutations conferring advantageous traits to help them adapt. Again, two things are wrong with this. One is always assuming mutations are good. Another is thinking that organisms selectively or deliberately mutate, okay, to adapt to the environment. Okay, please take note that mutations are not always positive. More often, they are harmful. But if it happens to give the organism a positive phenotype or feature, then yes, it can actually become quite significant. Okay? Okay, humans evolved from chimpanzees. What do you think about this? This one I want answer. Noah? You know why? Okay, so why? How would you improve this statement? How do you improve this statement? Okay, I can let you go already after this. Humans and chimpanzees share, yes, a recent common ancestor. Alright, we did not evolve from monkeys. Okay, so similarly, you cannot think that you are more superior to monkeys. Okay, you're not more superior to monkeys. You just evolve, you basically accumulated different traits in your own lineages. So monkeys are better at swinging from tree to tree. Are you good at swinging from tree to tree? No. Okay, then the monkey will say, I'm more superior because I can swing from tree to tree. You're lousy. Okay, Okay, so it's not true. Okay. Another thing that a student wants, Miss Tay and me, will humans evolve in future? You might want to go and think about this. I have two articles here for you. Predictions by this particular scientist. Prediction one. Okay, was that human evolution is dead. Prediction two is humans will continue to evolve. Okay, they are contradicting concepts. He was trying to give a balanced view. The article is in the slides which I will upload, so please go and just read through. Okay, to kind of, this is just for your own knowledge. Okay, and for you to ponder about. Okay, about whether we will evolve. Okay? Okay, thank you very much. Sorry for holding you back. Tomorrow we will do promos discussion. Okay, see you tomorrow. Thank you.